Dear students and friends, welcome to part 2 series. In this lecture, in which we are going to discuss all about radiopharmaceuticals from your 4th semester, which is covered under topic of dispensing and community pharmacy. I am Dr. Satish Belamkar, and content expert of this lecture is Professor Vandana Soni. Before I move ahead in this lecture, I would like to tell you what you are going to learn in this lecture. This lecture is divided into 5 modules in which we will try to cover storage and handling of radioactive material. I would like to give you detail of basic safety principles for radioactive materials. It also includes environment control and protection against radiopharmaceuticals. Radioactive contamination and its effects on health is a major problem associated with the radiopharmaceuticals. Hence, this is the main topic to discuss in this lecture. There are various types of radioactive contamination, such as low level contamination and high level contamination. Depending upon the exposure to the radioactive substances, they may cause hazardous biological and psychological effect on human health. So, let's have a look on modules which we are going to learn today. In module 1, radiopharmaceuticals, storage and handling of radioactive material. Module 2, storage of radioactive material. Module 3, environmental control and protection against exposure to radiopharmaceuticals. Module 4, radioactive contamination. Module 5, health effects of contamination. And finally, conclusion. Radiopharmaceuticals. Radiopharmaceuticals are unique medicinal formulations containing radioisotopes which are used in major clinical areas for diagnosis and or therapy. The facilities and procedures for the production, use and storage of radiopharmaceuticals are subject to licensing by national and or regional authorities. This licensing includes compliance both with regulations governing pharmaceutical preparations and with those governing radioactive materials. Additional regulations may apply for issues such as transportation or dispensing of radiopharmaceuticals. Storage and handling of radioactive material. Storage and handling of the radioactive material is always a tedious job. We have to take many precautions during handling of radiopharmaceuticals. Always wear protective clothing like disposable gloves, lab coat, safety glasses, etc. When handling radioactive materials, work in a fume hood if gas, vapor, dust or aerosols can occur during the procedure. Monitor the rooms where radioactivity is used or stored and pay special attention to all areas which may come in contact with potentially contaminated hands, example phones, doorknobs and refrigerator handles. Assume that containers labeled with the caution radioactive materials are may also be contaminated and wear disposable gloves when handling all such containers. Radioactive materials must be secured or under constant surveillance to prevent unauthorized removal. Lock and secure stock vials when not in use. Employ the 3 basic safety principles of time, distance and shielding when working with external hazards, and employ good housekeeping techniques when using any radioactive material. Perform liquid radiation work on a non-porous tray which is capable of containing the entire volume of a liquid radioactive material in case it is spilled. Cover the work area with plastic-backed absorbent material. Do not eat, drink, or perform other hand-to-mouth procedures like licking stamps or labels, applying makeup, etc. In any room or lab which has been posted, caution, radioactive materials. Do not pipette by mouth. Do not bring personal belongings into the radioactive work area of the lab. Avoid wearing rings, watches, and similar items during work. Wearing shorts or open-toed shoes is also not recommended. Do not work with radioactive materials if you have an open cut or wound. Do not store food or drink containers in the same location of radioactive materials. This particularly applies to refrigerators containing or labeled as containing radioactive materials. If issued a radiation dosimeter, wear it when working with radiation sources. When doing a new procedure, perform a dry run without radioactive materials to learn the procedure. Immediately after use or work with radioactive materials, wash hands, then monitor them thoroughly. Monitor hands and clothing for radioactive contamination during and after work, especially before leaving the lab. If you are contaminated or suspect that you are contaminated, wash the contaminated area and re-monitor as necessary. Workers should be thoroughly familiar with the properties of the radionuclides they are using. Here, I am going to discuss one of the very important safe practices to be followed every time. So, please have attention on these points. Safe practices must be followed every time. Warnings must be posted in work and storage areas. Handle and store radioactive material only in specifically designated and authorized locations. Posting must include the message "Caution, radioactive material" and display the radiation symbol when required. Doors of refrigerator and incubators in which radioactive materials are stored and doors labs using radioactive materials must also be labeled. Cover wounds. Properly dress and cover open wounds before working with radioactive materials. Wear disposable gloves. Wear disposable gloves at all times when handling radioactive material or potentially contaminated items. Environment health and safety recommends that two pairs of disposable gloves must be worn when working with millicurie amounts of tritium or iodine-125 or iodine-131. The outer pair should be changed frequently to prevent the radioactive material from permeating the glow. Wear lab coats and safety glasses. Wear lab coats and safety glasses when working with radioactive material and remove them when leaving the work area or lab. Personal monitoring. After each procedure and before leaving the area, we must be monitor hands, shoes and clothing for contamination using an appropriate radiation detection instrument. Area monitoring. Properly survey the work area for contamination during and after each procedure and at the end of the day. If any contamination is found, decontaminate before leaving the work area. Time, distance, shielding. Remember, time, distance and shielding are the means of reducing the radiation dose when working with radioactive material. Plan work in advance to save time. Use tongs, clamps, tweezers, etc. to provide distance from the source. Use appropriate shielding to reduce the radiation. Use appropriate shielding for each type of radionuclide. For example, shield 32P with 3x8 inch of plexiglass. Iodine-125 can be shielded with 1/8 inch of lead shielding or lead glass equivalent. Wear dosimeter. Wear a dosimeter properly and when required. No food or drink in the lab. In laboratories that use unsealed radioactive material or other hazardous materials, no eating or drinking is allowed anywhere in the laboratory. No storage of food or beverages for human consumption is allowed in laboratories, cold rooms, freezers, coolers, or refrigerators used for storage or use of hazardous materials including radioactive materials. No mouth pipetting. Do not pipette by mouth. Prepare work area properly. Use disposable absorbent material with impervious backing to cover work surfaces wherever radioactive material is used. Clearly label the work area with radioactive tape and identify the radionuclide and amount of radioactive material in use. Label and lock it. Store radioactive material in a clearly labeled and tightly closed containers. Secure against unauthorized removal. If stock vials are left unattended for more than 5 minutes, they should be locked up or the room itself should be locked. Radioisotope fume hood. When opening or handling volatile radionuclides or those with the potential to volatilize, use radioisotope fume hoods. Unbound iodine 125 or iodine 131 can be more volatile at lower pH. Large amounts of sulfur isotope 35 have been known to volatilize. Products labeled with tritium 3 can be volatile when stored in a chemical solvent. Tritiated products become especially volatile when the solvent is evaporated. Dispose of radioactive sharps as radioactive waste. Sharps contaminated with radioactive material must be placed in sharps containers labeled for radioactive material. Dispose of waste properly. Only dispose of radioactive materials in specially designated and clearly identified waste containers. Do not use biohazard bags for radioactive waste. Radioactive liquid waste must be completely absorbed before disposal. If liquid scintillation vials are used, environment, health and safety will accept plastic and glass liquid scintillation vials for pickup. Follow the radioactive waste disposal procedures in Chapter 6 Hazardous Waste Directory. Handling of scintillation fluids. There are only 3 liquid scintillation counting products currently approved by the Washington Department of Ecology for disposal in the sanitary sewer. They are soluble in water and contain less than 10% non-ionic surfactants. These products are Perkin-Elmer Microsynt O, Perkin-Elmer Optiflor, National Diagnostic EcoSynt. Whenever possible, use one of the products listed above. Do not use LSE fluids that contain toluene or xylene without environment, health and safety approval. So students, hope the idea of safe practices and handling of radiopharmaceuticals is clear to you now. If at any instance you have missed any part of this lecture, you may log on to our website for e-contents, for MCQ and many more. The web address is www.cec.nic.in. Module 2, Storage of Radioactive Material. Storage of radioactive materials is quite important and precaution is required every time. All storage locations housing the emitters should be checked with a gamma survey meter for the production of Bremsstrahlung radiation. To reduce such radiation, all emitters should not be stored in containers with high atomic numbers. Once opened, all vials containing unbound sources should not be stored in refrigerators, but store in fume hoods, and every effort made to keep these vessels tightly sealed. Shielding should be arranged to avoid blocking rear exhaust slots or hood faces. Storage locations for radioactive materials such as refrigerators should be labeled with the caution radioactive material signs. Storage containers and waste containers should also be labeled with caution radioactive material signs. Disposal of radioactive material. All waste contaminated with radioisotopes must be disposed of as radioactive waste. In particular, solid waste should be packed in clear plastic bags. It should not contain pourable liquids or animal carcasses. Needles, pipettes and other sharp objects should be placed in a puncture-proof sharps containers to protect the waste handler and to prevent piercing the waste bag. Radioactive waste with short half-life may be stored and some liquid waste can be diluted until their activities drop below acceptable levels and then disposed as normal waste. Example, very low levels of radioactive isotopes may be discharged into the sewer system. Separate single monthly discharge limits are established for solid waste disposed as normal waste and liquid waste discharged into the sewer system to cover all operations for the entire campus. The exact quantities vary as a function of the specific isotopes involved. Before any such discharge of radioactive isotopes, the user must seek the permission of the RPO by providing the estimated quantity to be discharged per month. Records of all subsequent discharges must then be kept by the user. Materials with non-dischargeable levels of radioisotopes should be segregated according to isotope and form and tagged with a radioactive waste label. Some may need to be stored on campus while others may need to be disposed by returning to the manufacturer or to the radiation board for long-term storage at designated locations. Module 3. Environmental control and protection against exposure to radiopharmaceuticals. Let's begin with environmental control and protection against exposure to radiopharmaceuticals. Medicinal radio compounds or radiopharmaceuticals are a group of pharmaceutical drugs which have radioactivity. Radiopharmaceuticals can be used as diagnostic and therapeutic agents. Individuals working with radiopharmaceuticals have a responsibility to take all reasonable precautions to protect patients, to protect members of the general public, to protect their colleagues, and most importantly, to protect themselves from unnecessary exposure to ionizing radiation. The guidelines listed below represent general guidance for individuals using radiopharmaceuticals. Although some of the following guidelines already discussed, but because of the serious side effects, here we discuss these guidelines again. Wear laboratory coats or other protective clothing at all times in areas where radioactive materials are used. Wear disposable gloves at all times while handling radioactive materials, either after each procedure or before leaving the area. Monitor hands and feet for contamination in a low background area using an appropriate survey instrument. Use syringe seals for reconstitution of radiopharmaceutical kits and administration of radiopharmaceuticals for patients, except when their use is contraindicated. Example, recessed veins, infants, etc. In these and other exceptional cases, use other protective methods such as remote delivery of the dose. Example, use a butterfly needle. Do not eat, store food, drink, smoke or apply cosmetics in any area where licensed material is stored or used. Wear personal monitoring devices if required at all times while in areas where radioactive materials are used or stored. These devices shall be worn as prescribed by the radiation safety officer. When not being worn to monitor occupational exposures, personal monitoring devices shall be stored in the workplace in a designated low background area. Wear extremity dosimeters if required when handling radioactive materials. Dispose of radioactive waste only in designated labeled and properly shielded receptacles. Never pipette by mouth. Wipe test unsealed by product, material storage, preparation and administration areas weekly for contamination. If necessary, decontaminate the area. Survey with a radiation detection survey meter in all areas of licensed material used. These areas including the generator storage, kit preparation and injection areas daily for contamination. If necessary, decontaminate the area. Areas used to prepare and administer therapy quantities of radiopharmaceuticals must be surveyed daily, except when administering therapy dosages in patients' rooms when patients are confined. Store radioactive solutions in shielded containers that are clearly labeled. Radiopharmaceutical multi-dose diagnostic and therapy vials must be properly labeled. Syringes and unit dosages must be labeled. Mark the label with the radionuclide and activity, the date for which the activity is estimated, and the kind of materials, that is radiopharmaceuticals. To avoid mistaking patient dosages, label the syringe with the type of study and the patient's name. For prepared dosages, assay each patient dosage in the dose calibrator or instrument before administering it. Do not use a dosage if it does not fall within the prescribed dosage range or if it varies more than 10% from the prescribed dosage, except as approved by the authorized user. When measuring the dosage, you need not consider the radioactivity that adheres to the syringe wall or remaining in the needle. Check the patient's name and identification number and the prescribed radionuclide, chemical form and dosage before administering. If the prescribed dosage requires a written directive, the patient's identity must be verified and the administration must be in accordance with the written directive policy. Check that the physician ordering administration of the radiopharmaceutical is an authorized user. A list of authorized users is posted on the radiation safety website at www.ehs.columbia.edu/radiationphysicians.html. Always keep flood sources, syringes, waste and other radioactive materials in shielded containers. Module 4. Radioactive contamination. This is one of the important module of this lecture and also for your future knowledge about radioactive contaminations. So, let's move ahead in this module. Radioactive contamination, low level contamination, the hazards to people and the environment from radioactive contamination depend on the nature of the radioactive contaminant, the level of contamination and the extent of the spread of contamination. Low levels of radioactive contamination pose little risk but can still be detected by radiation instrumentation. If a survey or map is made of a contaminated area, random sampling locations may be labeled with their activity. In Becquerel or Curie's on contact, low levels may be reported in counts per minute using a scintillation counter. In the case of low level contamination by isotopes with a short off life, the best course of action may be to simply allow the material to naturally decay. Longer lived isotopes should be cleaned up and properly disposed of because even a very low level of radiation can be life threatening when in long exposure to it. Facilities and physical locations that are deemed to be contaminated may be cordoned off by a health physicist and labeled contaminated area. Persons coming near such an area would typically require anti-contamination clothing. High level contamination. High levels of contamination may pose major risks to people and the environment. People can be exposed to potentially lethal radiation levels both externally and internally from the spread of contamination following an accident or a deliberate initiation involving large quantities of radioactive material. The biological effects of external exposure to radioactive contamination are generally the same as those from an external radiation source not involving radioactive materials such as X-ray machines and are dependent on the absorbed dose. When radioactive contamination is being measured or mapped in situ, any location that appears to be a point source of radiation is likely to be heavily contaminated. A highly contaminated location is colloquially referred to as a hot spot. On a map of a contaminated place, hot spots may be labeled with their on-contact dose rate in millisieverts per hour. In a contaminated facility, hot spots may be marked with a sign shielded with bags of lead shot or cordoned off with warning tape containing the radioactive trefoil symbol. Alpha radiation consists of helium-4 nucleus and is readily stopped by a sheet of paper. Beta radiation consisting of electrons is halted by an aluminium plate. Gamma radiation is eventually absorbed as it penetrates a dense material. Lead is good at absorbing gamma radiation due to its density. The hazard from contamination is the emission of ionizing radiation. The principal radiations which will be encountered are alpha, beta and gamma, but these have quite different characteristics. They have widely differing penetrating powers and radiation effect, and the accompanying diagram shows the penetration of these radiation in simple terms. For an understanding of the different ionizing effects of these radiations and the weighting factors applied, see the article on absorbed dose. Radiation monitoring involves the measurement of radiation dose or radionuclide contamination for reasons related to the assessment or control of exposure to radiation or radioactive substances and the interpretation of the results. Background radiation. In the natural world, there is always radiation emitted from radionuclide as they decay. Not only is the entire world constantly bombarded by cosmic rays, but practically every living thing on earth contains carbon-14 and tritium, and most, including humans, contains some potassium-40. These levels of radioactivity pose little danger but can confuse measurement. A particular problem is encountered with naturally generated radon gas, which can affect instruments which are said to detect contamination close to normal background levels and can cause the false alarms. Because of this, skill is required by the operator of radiological survey equipment to differentiate between background radiation and the radiation which emanates from contamination. Module 5, Health Effects of Contamination. Another important module in this lecture is all about health effects of contamination. Radioactive contamination has wider and long time impact on environment to professional associated. It carries biological effects, external and internal radiations, last but not the least, psychological effects. Biological effects. Radioactive contamination by definition emits ionizing radiation, which can irradiate the human body from an external or internal origin. External irradiation. This is due to radiation from contamination located outside the human body. The source can be in the vicinity of the body or can be on the skin surface. The levels of health risk is dependent on duration and the type and strength of irradiation. Penetrating radiation such as gamma rays, X-rays, neutrons or beta particles pose the greatest risk from an external source. Low penetrating radiation such as alpha particles have a low external risk due to the shielding effect of the top layers of skin. See the article on sievert for more information on how this is calculated. Internal irradiation. Radioactive contamination can be ingested into the human body if it is airborne or is taken in as contamination of food or drinking, and will irradiate the body internally. The art and science of assessing internally generated radiation dose is internal dosimetry. The biological effects of ingested radionuclides depend greatly on the activity, biodistribution and removal rates of the radionuclide, which in turn depends on its chemical form, particle size and route of entry. Effects may also depend on the chemical toxicity of the deposited material, independent of its radioactivity. Some radionuclides may be generally distributed throughout the body and rapidly removed, as is the case with tritiated water. Some organs concentrate certain radionuclide variants of elements. This action may lead to much lower removal rates. For instance, the thyroid gland takes up a large percentage of any iodine that enters the body. Large quantities of inhaled or ingested radioactive iodine may impair or destroy the thyroid, while other tissues are affected to a lesser extent. Radioactive iodine-131 is a common fission product. It was a major component of the radioactivity released from the Chernobyl disaster, leading to 9 fatal cases of pediatric thyroid cancer and hypothyroidism. On the other hand, radioactive iodine is used in the diagnosis and treatment of many diseases of the thyroid, precisely because of the thyroid's selective uptake of iodine. The radiation risk proposed by the International Commission on Radiological Protection predicts that an effective dose of 1 sievert carries 5.5% chance of developing cancer. Such a risk is the sum of both internal and external radiation dose. The ICRP states, radionucleates incorporated in the human body irradiate the tissues over time periods determined by their physical half-life and their biological retention within the body. Thus, they may give rise to doses to body tissues for many months or years after the intake. The need to regulate exposures to radionucleates and the accumulation of radiation dose over extended periods of time has led to the definition of committed dose quantities. The ICRP further states, for internal exposure, committed effective doses are generally determined from an assessment of the intakes of radionucleates from biosay measurements or other quantities, example, activity retained in the body or in daily excreta. The radiation dose is determined from the intake using recommended dose coefficients. The ICRP defines 2 dose quantities for individual committed dose. Committed equivalent dose, HT. It is the time integral of the equivalent dose rate in a particular tissue or organ that will be received by an individual following intake of radioactive material into the body by a reference person, where T is the integration time in years. This refers specifically to the dose in a specific tissue or organ in a similar way to external equivalent dose. Committed effective dose, ET. It is the sum of the products of the committed organ or tissue equivalent doses and the appropriate tissue weighing factors, WT, where T is the integration time in years following the intake. The commitment period is taken to be 50 years for adults and to age 70 years for children. This refers specifically to the dose to the whole body in a similar way to external effective dose. Psychological effects. The consequences of low level radiation are often more psychological than radiological because damage from very low level radiation cannot be detected. People exposed to it are left in the anguished uncertainty about what will happen to them. Many believe they have been fundamentally contaminated for life and may refuse to have children for fear of birth defects. They may be shunned by others in their community who fear a sort of mysterious contagion. Forced evacuation from a radiological or nuclear accident may lead to social isolation, anxiety, depression, psychosomatic medical problems, reckless behavior, even suicide. Such was the outcome of the 1986 Chernobyl nuclear disaster in the Ukraine. Comprehensive 2005 study concluded that the mental health impact of Chernobyl is the largest public health problem unleashed by the accident to date. Frank N. Von Hippel, a US scientist, commented on the 2011 Fukushima nuclear disaster, saying that fear of ionizing radiation could have long-term psychological effects on a large portion of the population in the contaminated areas. Such great psychological danger does not accompany other materials that put people at risk of cancer and from coal burning. Although, as the National Academy of Sciences study found, this causes 10,000 premature deaths a year in the US population of more than 31 billion. Medical errors leading to death in US hospitals are estimated to be between 44,000 and 98,000. It is only nuclear radiation that bears a huge psychological burden, for it carries a unique historical legacy. Conclusion. So friends, here we come at the end of this important topic. In brief, we can conclude this chapter with these following points in our mind. Radiopharmaceuticals are the special type of medicinal formulations containing radioisotopes which are used in major clinical areas for diagnosis and our therapy. Radiopharmaceuticals are the theranostic medicine. The theranostic medicine is relatively a new term that describes integration of diagnostic and therapeutic functions within the same platform of pharmaceuticals. Such a design may in principle permit the molecular diagnosis, targeted therapy and simultaneous monitoring and treatment necessary to achieve personalized medicine for cancer. Theranostic radiopharmaceuticals, for instance, carry the properties of both diagnostic radioimaging and radioimmunotherapy. Hence, there is the need of controlled use of radiopharmaceuticals with desired safety and precautions. Last but not the least, keep our website link in your mind if you have missed any of the lectures in this series, that is www.cec.nic.in. There you can find many contents, LORs, FAQs, assignments and many more. Keep studying and do keep in mind what we have discussed today. I'll be back with one more lecture in this series, that is Radiopharmaceuticals Part 3. Till then, keep studying. Goodbye.